your good and your mercy endureth forever. We, the redeemed of the Lord, shall say so, whom we you have redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Father, we have been redeemed from the curse of the law. We've been delivered from the power of darkness. We've been translated into the kingdom of your dear Son. We thank you this evening for the work that you have begun in us. We thank you, Lord, that the work that you have begun, you will continue to perform it. We thank you for your grace. Your grace is sufficient, and you're able, Father, to cause all grace. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, yebidihishanda. Yebidihishanda. You're able to keep us from falling. You're able to present us faultless before your presence with exceeding great joy. We thank you tonight for the grace of God that brings salvation. That grace hath appeared to all men, teaching us denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we should live righteously, godly, yes, and soberly in this present world. Father, we are looking for that glorious appearing, yes, that blessed hope and glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you. We give you praise and the glory tonight. Oh, for every good and every perfect gift. For we know that every good and every perfect gift cometh from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Oh, we rejoice tonight. We give you praise. We give you the glory due your name. We worship you in the beauty of holiness. We thank you tonight, Lord. Hallelujah. Libidi Kandala Mahoshanda. We thank you. We thank you. Oh, Ribihishanda. We give you praise and we give you the glory right now in Jesus' name. I'd like for everybody to stand just for 2 or 3 minutes. If you can, let's pray in the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you. Halamanomahoshanda. We don't know how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercessions for us with utterance that we cannot, yes, articulate with our intellect. Oh, we know that we can accomplish much more. We can pray that perfect prayer. Oh, God, we can pray the perfect will of God. Oh, we can pray for things unknown. Oh, we can pray for things in the power of the Holy Ghost. Yes, how overcoming every limitation, every barrier, every hindrance. And we can pray the will of God into existence. Hey, as we pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and without doubting. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Glory be Ishande. Your grace is sufficient, Lady Mahishanda. Lord, our sufficiency is of you. Oh, God, we give you the glory. Oh, it's not according to our feelings. It's not according to our thinking. Hey, it's not according to our conditions and our the predicament that we find ourselves in. But we praise you, Lord, because you are worthy to be praised. We praise you. Because you have commanded us to pray, hey, hallelujah, with our whole heart lifted up holy hands. Yes, giving you praise and the glory. Yes, for all that you have done for us. You have redeemed us. Yes, you have saved us. When we were dead in trespasses and sins, you quickened us together with you. Yes, and you in by grace we're saved through faith. Yes, it's not of ourselves, it is the gift of God. We thank you this evening, Father. We give you the praise, we give you the glory. In Jesus' name, oh God, in Jesus' name. Not only did you save us, but you raised us up to sit with you in heavenly places. Far above principality and power. Oh God, we're seated in heavenly places. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You are the mediator. You are the author and the finisher of our faith. You are a great priest. Hey, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, God, consistently making intercession for us. Oh, God, we thank you today. that you are working your will and the due of your good pleasure in us. Yes, you effectually working in all of them that believe you. Oh God, we're trusting you. We're looking to you. Hey, hey. Yes, yes, yes. Hallelujah. Oh, your promises are sure. Yeah, yeah, to every seed. Oh God, oh God, oh God, your covenant, you said you will never break it. Neither alter the things that have come out of your mouth. We give you praise and we give you the glory. Hey, hey, in Jesus' name, the name above every name, we thank you, Father, for the victory. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. We give you praise and we give you the glory for it now, in Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Oh, the wonderful name, the mighty name, the precious name, the name above every name. Oh, the glorious name, no other name. Oh God, we thank you, we give you praise, and we give you the glory now, in Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. I just want to just say that we appreciate all of you that have made your way here. Amen, so far. Amen. We have some interesting things that we're going to be sharing with you. And I was just thinking the other day, I was just thinking that every person that's knowledgeable of the end time predictions and the end time prophecies ought to really strive to be counted worthy to be received by Christ when he comes back in the air. Amen. I think that's a goal that all of us should desire, to be prepared, to be ready. Amen. Because we believe that Christ is coming, is imminent. Amen. I know that people have been saying that for many years, and even in Jesus' day, people were expecting the soon coming of Christ. I need somebody to help me. And so people are, God's people, believers have been eagerly awaiting Christ's return for about 2,000 years. And so we tonight are going to look at a lot of different aspects of Christ's return. We have, before we get into the handout tonight, we are in lessons. We were reading up to chapter 6. Chapters 1, 2, 3, especially chapters 2 and 3 dealing with the seven churches that the Apostle John was writing to, the seven churches in Asia that the prophet John was writing to. And these churches represented churches in every era, E-R-A, of Christian history. Some of them are churches that are still in existence today. The Laodicean church, the Philadelphia church, and some even think that Father's church, one of them, is still in existence. But these letters were written to the church to let the church know that in order for them to be prepared for Jesus when he comes back, then there were certain adjustments that they needed to make in their services of a commitment, their faith, and their lifestyle and their commitment faithfulness and all of that toward God. So these things were spelled out in those seven letters to those churches. And I believe the first church, y'all remember, was the church that, what we call it, the loveless church. Amen. So you need to be reading all of this too so that you can get the full picture. The church, loveless church, referred to what? The church that had lost its what? First love, right? And that was the church at Ephesus. All right, so the admonition, the warning was to repent and to do your first works over. Okay, when you say you lost your first love, that means you have lost your pure devotion, your sincere pure devotion that you initially started out with when you were so turned on and when you were so fervent and sincere about the things of God. It takes that anointing and that fire to sustain the believer. Believe it or not, it takes fire, fire, fire. That's the reason why the scripture admonishes us to be filled with the Holy Ghost and with what?
Fire.
Fire. Because it takes fire to even get your prayers answered. It takes fire to live an overcoming life. Is that right? You have to be on fire. Amen. Christ has to be alive. The anointing has to be what? Working and moving and operating. You need to be, you know, we have to be praying in the Holy Ghost. That's when we first started out, we were praying in the Holy Ghost. We were dancing. How many of you used to dance? Amen. But somewhere down the line, amen, we said, well, that's, I'm too intelligent. I'm too sophisticated. All right. But when we lose our grip on God, many times we can see ourselves, our power and our anointing waning. I remember that the testimony of believers used to penetrate those that weren't believers, used to penetrate. They came in a conviction. They desired what you had. Sometimes they wept and cried. Their hearts were touched and challenged just from the words that came out of the mouths of those that were believers. So we see in the first church that Christ told that church that if they did repent and return to their first love, then he would remove the candlestick. That means that the church would be destroyed. Amen. It would be wiped out. Of course, we know later on, eventually, that church was wiped out by, I think Arthur mentioned, the Mohammedans or the Muslims faith. Amen. So, but anyway, with each church, God gave them the blessings and the rewards that would be received when they overcame. I believe the first church mentioned that if they overcame, amen, God would, he mentioned the things that he would cause them to eat off the tree of life in the garden of God, paradise of God, the tree of life. Amen. How many know the tree of life was the tree that Jesus described that brought forth 12 different fruits? Amen. Per month, each month, it brought forth 12 different kinds of fruit. Must have been some powerful fruit, because it said the leaves of that tree was good for the healing of the nations. Amen. That's the tree that Adam and Eve were forbidden to eat of, to partake of when they were in the Garden of Eden, because if they had partaken of that tree, they would have lived forever. Yes. Amen. That was after they had, when they had sinned, God drove them out of that place, right? Lest they ate of that tree of good and evil. Amen. So therefore, that is worth the effort, the sufferings, the commitment, amen, to be able to eat freely of the tree of life.
Amen. Some of y'all might be happy with bologna and hot dogs, hamburgers, and your pork chops. Amen. But the tree of life is a tree that's good for the what? Healing of the nations. Amen. To tell the truth, it will be people that will be in their physical bodies all throughout the millennium. Amen. And even throughout eternity, there will be people, amen, that will be experiencing the glory and the power of God, even in their physical state. God made us to live in our physical state forever if we hadn't sinned. Amen. Even believers in their glorified bodies will be, hallelujah, will be living with the Lord forever in there. How many old people in the glorified body can eat? Amen. Jesus ate after he was glorified, wasn't he? All right, so all of us are going to have some good meals. Amen. It's going to be better than IHOP. It's going to be better than Luda's. It's going to be better than McDonald's. It's going to be a fruit, amen, that's good for the healing of the nations. Bear for 12 different kinds of fruit. My God, how many eat 12 different kinds of fruit now? Some of y'all don't like fruit at all, do you? All right. So that was a good observation concerning each church that he wrote. The second church was the Smyrna church, was a suffering church. The first church was a loveless church. Ephesus was a church that was loveless. They had lost their first love. And they were admonished to repent and do their first works over again. And there were consequences if they refused to do that. He said that the candlestick would be removed. In other words, the church's existence would be on the line. All right, the second church was Smyrna, and we know that the Smyrna church was the church that was a suffering church, and he had nothing but what good things to say about them, and eventually he told them to be faithful unto what? Death, and he will give them a what? Crown of life. So everyone that suffer for the sake of the gospel, you're going to be given a crown. That was a church that experienced a whole lot of persecution, a whole lot of imprisonment. Many of them were put to death. I believe 5 million plus were put to death during that particular era. And they were bitterly and cruelly opposed and treated. Amen. But God gave them a word. He told them, amen, that you're going to have tribulation. You're going to suffer. Amen. The devil is going to cast some of you into prison, but be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. And he said, he that overcome shall not be hurt of the second death. That was the promise to that church. That was good. That means that the second death will not have power over those, amen, that overcome. That means that we won't have to face second death. That's something that unbelievers can't say. Unbelievers will face the second death because they will be resurrected after the end of the millennium period, and then they will stand before their judgment, which is called the white throne judgment, and they will give an account of the deeds. And the scripture says that the death in hell and the adulterers and all of those that are going to be condemned to the second death or to eternal death will be cast into a lake of fire. And believe me, in the lake of fire, Gehenna, is going to be different degrees of suffering. Different degrees of suffering. That's the reason why the Bible mentions in Romans 2 about when people reject and won't do, they are treasuring up wrath against the day of wrath. Amen. That means that their punishment is going to be what? More severe. They're going to be judged according to how many times that they rejected the Lord and how many, amen, all of the opportunities that they had and all of the acts of ungodliness that they committed. but some will be punished even more. The Bible says he that committed things worthy of stripes will be beaten with what? Some will be beaten with few, and some will be beaten with what? Many. All right. So, how many would like to overcome? How many would like to be an overcomer, so you don't have to be confronted with second death, eternal death? In other words, you won't even show up at that resurrection. Amen. You'll be in the what? First. Blessed is he. Amen. That have part in the what? First resurrection. He's going to be blessed. All right. The third church we mentioned about the church over at the other church was the church at Thyatira. Is that Pergamos, right? And that was the worldly church. The worldly church. And that was the church that they brought all types of religions and paganistic customs into the church, because Christianity eventually became the church of the state. In other words, the religion of the state. They outlawed all other religions except Christianity. That was a result of the tenacity of those suffering believers that went through all of the persecution, fed to lions, thrown in sacks, bags, leather bags with snakes and scorpions, and thrown in the river. Many times they were thousands and tens of thousands gathered at the amphitheater and watched believers being fed to lions. But the thing that caused the gospel to spread was that when the people that were casting them to the lions, and the people that were atheists and heathens, and that were into idolatry, when they saw the praise and the glory and the power and the anointing on these people and how they died, when they died what? Rejoicing. They died praising God. Amen. They died with the joy of the Lord in their hearts. And when they saw that joy, they said, I want what those people got. I want what these people, whatever they believe. Amen. My religion, my God, the idol God, they said that that fervency, that zeal, amen, for my God is not as powerful and as intense as that which is coming from these Christians. So the blood of Christians was the seed of the growth of the Christian church. The blood of the Christian, that was the seed that caused the church to grow to the point where they had to what? Make Christianity the religion of the whole state, the whole empire. Amen. So when that happened, of course, you know, a whole lot of people got in the church without getting saved. And that's when a whole lot of paganistic teaching and heathen teaching and compromise, and the church became worldly. Amen. So that was the reason why that church was the church they called the worldly church, because a whole lot of people had gotten into the church and brought all of their pagan gods and all of their customs and traditions that they couldn't legally involve themselves in, because their religions had been outlawed. So they brought all of that stuff into what? Christianity. Amen. And then they kept on doing a whole lot of stuff, and then eventually the doctrines of the Nicolaitans and the doctrine of Balaam and all of that permeated that church, and it became weak, and it began to be a church that compromised the real values that they, moral values that they started out with. Okay. The next church, let me see what was the promise to them if they overcome. To him that overcome, this is chapter 2 and 17. To him that overcome will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and the stone a new name written which no man knoweth, saving he that received it. That was the promise even to that church. If they would repent, amen, and
turn back and get rid of all of these things that displease God. Amen. Now, the church at Thyatira, that was the paganistic church, as we were saying, that the church began to be infiltrated by paganism, and that church was the church that he said in verse 19, I know thy works and charity and service and faith and thy patience and thy works. So there were people that were actually making a stand, they were performing works, and they were, you know, living for God, making a stand for God, and they were committed people. But yet he condemned that church because they tolerated a whole lot of a whole lot of doctrines that were not biblical. They said, you suffered that woman, the prophet Jezebel, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And to that church he said that he that overcometh, verse 26, and keeping my words until the end, to him will I give power over the nations. Okay, now that verse 27 says, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I receive of my Father, and I will give him the morning star. Okay, so that was the promise. Now it says that he that overcometh and keepeth my works until the end, to him will I give power over the nations. Now that's important, that we continue the works of God, doing what God has called us to do all the way to the end. Let me just give you a scripture here Hebrews that you really will be blessed by. It says, Hebrews 3, verse 14, for we are made partakers of Christ, and we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the what? End. Amen. So the race is not given to the swift, neither the battle to the strong, but it's given to him that what? Endureth until the end. So it's very important that we do the things that's necessary in order for us to sustain ourselves spiritually. That's the reason why consistency, commitment to prayer, and seeking God, things that will keep you spiritually alive and on fire, so that your obedience will be of the nature where your works will be sustained all the way to the end, because you can really lose your rewards. Amen. Paul was fearful of even losing his rewards. That's the reason why he said, I keep under my what? Body. Amen. I press forward towards the mark for the prize of the high calling, which is in what? Christ Jesus. He was very concerned about how he walked, how he lived, and how well he disciplined and controlled his body, because he knew that if he would turn back and begin to, you know, sometimes people start in the spirit and try to end it in the flesh. But that won't work. Tell somebody, that won't work. If you, amen. You can't start in the Holy Ghost in the spirit and what? End in the flesh. Amen. So you have to stay on fire. You have to do a whole lot of things to what? To bring yourself to the point where whatever you are doing for God will be what? Acceptable unto him. It's got to be acceptable unto God. Otherwise, you can what? You can lose your reward. Amen. Some of y'all don't believe you're going to lose your reward. Amen. You can have those spiritual points stacked up to the ceiling, so to speak, and turn around and get in the flesh. You know, sometimes people like to live for the devil a little bit even after they get saved. They just enjoy. Say, oh, I want to go back and do some things that I used to do that really gave me pleasure. By the way, what we know, the pleasures of sin are just going to be for what? A season. And then what you lose out, and you lose on all of those points when you were on fire, when you were seeking God, when you were sincere, is that right? When you only approved the things that were excellent, right? Amen. You didn't, amen. You didn't, you know, slip and slide and what they call it, what, duck and dive. I mean, you weren't doing stuff under the cover. Amen. You were just what? Straight. Amen. You know, I always tell them, turn right and go straight. You won't have no problem. Turn right and go straight. You won't have no problem. Okay, so that's really important. Let me just give you a an admonition here that would really help you. Colossians 1, 1:1:1, Colossians 1:21, and you that were sometime, this is Colossians 1:21, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. That is the condition of a person that have become the righteousness of God. When you first say, amen, you without spot, you are holy, you are unblameable, and unreprovable. The scripture even say, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So your spirit man is recreated, and he becomes a what? Brand new person. Amen. He's holy, unblameable. He is what? He is unreprovable. And that spirit in you is holy. Okay, but your mind or your soul and your body, your mind has to be what? Renewed. Is that right? Right? Your mind has to be renewed and your body has to be brought in what? Subjection. You gotta what? Control. You gotta what? Rule your what? Physical body. If you don't rule your physical body, then amen, your mind will not be able to what? To rule and control your body. Is that right? The spirit man has to be what? Developed. You gotta grow, you gotta feed it, right? You gotta exercise the spirit man. That's the reason why fasting and prayer and consecration. This is what? Feeding the what? The inner man. Feeding the what? Spirit man, so that the spirit man will rise to his place where it can what? Amen, praise God, cause the what? Mind and the body, amen, to be under his what? Dominion. Once the spirit gets strong, then the mind becomes what? Renewed. When you develop and cultivate your spirit, feed it, amen, and let your spirit exercise. You got to feed it. You know, if you just ate all the time and then exercise, you still wouldn't be healthy. You still wouldn't be as strong as you should be. You have to eat and then, amen, then what? Sit on the couch, right? Now that won't work. That's our problem now, right? Amen. That's the reason why you have so many people. That's the reason why so many people are dying prematurely, and it's because they do not exercise themselves physically. They don't exercise. That's the reason that it's the surest way, the quickest way to the marble arching. When you fail to exercise physically. Y'all wanna know what the marble arch is? Y'all know what the marble arch is? That's the what? The grave with all the what? Marble, the tombstone. All right, that's the quickest way to the marble arch is just being what? Just being, what's the word when people don't exercise? What? She said lazy. It's a better word. What's the good word? Sedentary, there you go. All right. So if your spirit is sedentary, amen, that means what? You're not going to experience victory and you won't be an overcomer. So that's the reason why you want to exercise your spirit. That's the reason why one of the best ways to exercise your spirit, but many of you don't understand the value of it, is to pray in the Holy Ghost a lot, to pray in the Spirit. Amen. Fast, amen, pray, read your Bible. Amen. Reach out to somebody. You gotta what? Minister to somebody. Just don't what? Take in food all the time. And receive the word, receive the word, receive the word, and don't what? Give it out. All of this is exercising your what? Spirit man. This is how you grow. And when your spirit grows and develops, then it exercises control over your mind, your decisions, your emotional life is impacted, right? Amen. Amen. And the spirit man gains the ascendancy over your what? Your soul and your body. All right. So this is what we want to do. Look, verse 23 says, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, see, your spirit is developed. I mean, it becomes a new creation. It's perfect before God. It's holy. It's unblameable.
But your soul, your mind, you got to do some work there, right? Your body, you're going to have to do some work. You're going to have to what? Amen. Exert some disciplines. Is that right? You're going to have to do some stuff in order to bring your soul and your body into subjection. So that's the reason why we do all of the things that we do in the body of Christ in terms of self-restraint. Because if we don't exercise temperance and self-restraint, amen, boy, you can be doing stuff in the church and just doing it in the power of your flesh. Just do it because you know how to do it. Sometimes ain't no life, ain't no motivation, no enthusiasm, no joy. Sometimes we're just dead as a doornail, right? Just dead, glory. That was the problem that John was confronting in the time of his writing. Okay, now, see, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of a gospel which you have heard and which was preached to every creature. So you just can't throw your hands up, give in and give up and faint and fall out and die and go back to your old ways and amen and backslide. That's all backsliding is, of what, going back, not being where you were. And there's some things all of us can do, amen, from what, keep from, I mean, and that will enable us to avoid what, sliding back. Amen. What about reading your Bible about an hour a day? Amen. I have three heads nodding. What about reading your Bible? What about praying in the Holy Ghost? What about coming for 5 o'clock prayer sometimes? See, we don't want to do nothing hard. Everything got to be what? Easy. And I always say, amen, that the way that people get crooked, the way that people backslide is because they follow the line of least resistance. That's the thing that really caused rivers to what, get crooked. Rivers will get crooked. You know how you know rivers just run this way? They always follow the line of what, least resistance. And that's the reason why we get crooked, because we always want the easy way out. And some of us would even entertain the idea of getting up at 5 o'clock. Amen. And to come out and get refreshed. God will just bless you for your sacrifice, right? I remember last week, that first morning we prayed for, and my boy, I'm telling you, was some real brokenness in here. Amen. It just seemed like your prayers, just what? Woo, glory. Boy, weeping and crying and brokenness. See, the sacrifice of God is a what? Broken spirit. God wants you to what? Break, to be broken. If he can't break you, he can't what? He can't make you or reshape you. He got to get what? That mess out of you. He takes what? Brokenness to get whatever in you that shouldn't be in there. And it also takes what? Brokenness to get inside of you what needs to be in there. Amen. So it's going to take some sacrifices. Amen. That's something that we'll learn once we get to heaven, if we make it, and start regretting all of the what times and opportunities that we had to what, to seek God and to come to worship and pray. Well, I would be glad if I was a struggling believer, amen, to find somebody that would be willing to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and pray with me. The many times we don't count spiritual things as being what, valuable. Amen. All right. Y'all hear? He says, look to yourself, second epistle of John, look to yourselves that ye, that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. This is second John, verse 8. So you can lose those things which you have what? All of those spiritual points that you have what? Built up for many, many years. Amen. When you were walking in the spirit and then start walking back in the flesh, then you can what? You can lose those things which you have reward, but that you have what? Wrought. But the scripture says, but that we receive a full reward. So you want to receive a full reward. Amen. So there's a scripture that I think all of you remember, Ezekiel 3, about those that
Ezekiel 3, I want to read this scripture here. Ezekiel 3, I think that you can, okay, this is Ezekiel 3, 17. Son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word of my mouth and give them warning from me. Now this is written to all of us as believers. This is our role. We are here in Christ's stead. When I say unto the wicked, verse 18, this is Ezekiel 3, thou shalt surely die, thou givest him not warning, nor speak it to warn the wicked from his wicked way, to save his life. The same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thine hand. So God is holding us accountable for those around us and those whose paths that we cross to share the word of God. See, the reason why many times we don't have the boldness and the confidence and the commitment and the anointing to do it is because of negligence in areas that I was speaking about earlier. See, if you don't want to make no sacrifice, no suffering, no cross, no what? Crown. No suffering, no what? No reigning. So you're not going to get tough enough in the spirit where you can impact people to the extent that you should until you experience what? Some hardness. Scripture says that we have to endure hardness as a what? Good soldier. Through much tribulation shall you enter into the kingdom of God. Amen. So it takes some suffering. It takes some pains. You have to put yourself at some disadvantages in order for the real glory of God to be revealed in you. The scripture says the light afflictions that we experience worketh, amen, for a more excellent weight of glory. The light afflictions. And think about the people that I was describing a few minutes ago that were cast, thrown into leather bags with snakes and scorpions and then thrown in the rivers. Just think about people that were fed to the lions at those amphitheaters, and people cheered and they had a ball as they were being devoured and picked apart member by member by those wild, vicious beasts. I mean, they paid a price for the salvation and for the gospel that we enjoy today. But many times we're not willing to what? To get up early one morning. Amen. And what? And deny ourselves of what? An hour to sleep. Amen. I guarantee you, if you make some sacrifices and become tough, amen, and deny your flesh and endure hardness, amen, and turn off the television and do a whole lot of things that's not contributing anything to your spiritual well-being, I guarantee you, you'll have some strength to convince somebody or to help somebody to get on the right track. Amen. Praise God. And I believe that even if we individually are not at the point where we can be convincing enough to get people saved, when enough of us get together and pray together and seek God together and fast and pray together and to deny our flesh together, it'll be enough anointing in here to arrest the attention off of what? The hardest sinner that even will show up in here. Amen. Amen. If one can't do it, sometimes two, well, the Bible says two is better than what? One. One can chase in 1,000, but two can put what? 10,000. If you can get 6 people, 12 people that will, amen, be willing to turn over that plate, amen, and come out every morning for 7 mornings. Amen. I guarantee you the anointing will, amen, will be 10,000 times stronger on Sunday, amen, to arrest the attention of what? Sinners. Amen. See, if y'all expecting me to do it all, and y'all just lay in the bed, watch television, amen, wait until 7 o'clock, until breakfast time come. Amen. See, we're not going to ever reach our potential. It's going to take on all of us. And where there's unity, there is what? Strength. Amen. I'm going to keep on reading. Yet if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wicked way, from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way. This is the 19th verse. The same shall die in his iniquity, but thou shalt have, but thou hast what? Delivered thy soul. Okay, watch this. Again, when a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness, and commit iniquity. These are backsliders, people that don't come to church, they don't show up. And I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall die, because thou hast not given him warning, and he shall die in his sin. So that shows that people that have started out with Christ, people that drift away, people that lose their first love, people that get complacent, amen, people that really don't continue as the word that we have shared earlier has stated that we must do. The Bible says many of these people are going to what, die in their sins. You know, I don't know whether you believe once in Christ, never out. I don't believe that. I believe that you can, amen, you can what, abuse grace. How many believe that? I believe the grace of God can be what, amen, can go for nothing for with some people if they don't what, tap into it or take advantage of it or not place themselves in a position where the grace of God can what, reach them. Sometimes people are all together out of a range where the grace of God can really get to them. So you got to what? Place your hand at the what? At the mercy of God.